Hey there, Michael here. In today's video, I want to revisit a couple of comments I made with respect to the use of generative artificial intelligence in the creative professions, in particular in music production. I recently published a video essay where I outlined three key cornerstones on how education needs to react to the emergence of generative artificial intelligence. If you have not seen that yet, I'll leave a link in the description below. I recommend that you check that out. What I want to talk about today is how this translates into creative professional practice. In other words, what do we have to do or change given that we are gaining access to incredibly powerful tools that can create content at ever-increasing speed and quality? And the way I want to do this is by answering and responding to some of the questions and comments you have posted on two of my videos about generative artificial intelligence in the music industry and in education. So here we go. Generative artificial intelligence is here and it's not going to go anywhere. What do we do now? Let's find out. Before I get into the questions and comments, I'd like to briefly revisit the three principles I was talking about in my video about AI in education. And while this video was primarily targeted at education in the creative fields, this principle actually applies to almost everything in our daily lives, in particular also to professional practices. And these three principles were, first of all, an emphasis on critical skills, and this includes not only critical thinking, but also critical reading, listening, critical seeing, or even critical making. The second principle was an emphasis on the process rather than the outcome. Within the context of creative professional practice, this will actually become one of the most important ways of thinking and acting. How something has been created becomes almost more important than what has been created. And we already see this happening today when artists need to document their creative process in order to prove that their creations have not been generated by artificial intelligence. And three, an emphasis on agile organizational structures so that we can react to technological progress in a timely manner. The world is moving fast and we need to be able to move with it. If you want to learn more about these three principles, I recommend checking out my original video. As I said before, I'll leave a link in the description below. Okay, so with that little recap out of the way, let's jump into the first comment. First comment comes from Raptorman0909, and this one has a lot of things to unpack, so let's get started. And Raptorman writes, "By my observation, the industry that's been most affected by AI is voiceover actors, and that's true, at least if you think about all the audio industries. I've heard what appears to be AI-generated voices that sound so much like a real person I've heard. I do believe that many actresses and actors, as well as other people with notable voices, have had their voices used to train AI, such that real people no longer own their voice and all money generated from their voice goes to the AI company. Scarlett Johansson had her voice stolen from her even after she told them no." Now, there are three things I wanted to point out in this particular comment, and the first one relates to the observation that voiceover actors are most affected by artificial intelligence, and that is actually true. I would think that if you are thinking about a career in voice acting, this might not be the best time to actually get into that. Now, one thing that I would say, though, is that this relates to the third principle that I was telling about, and that is being agile. You need to be aware that things change and you need to be able to move. This is something that I actually experienced myself. Not a lot of people know, but my original degree was in a topic that's called descriptive geometry. And that is a field that was used before the emergence of computers when architects needed to make architectural drawings. So what I actually learned was how to use ink in order to create architectural drawings. Now, when I essentially kind of entered that field as an educator, it became very, very clear very, very soon that that's not a field that has a lot of future, because computers came around in the 80s and 90s, and then suddenly nobody needed to use ink anymore and do the drawings by hand with ink. You just would use a computer and a computer-aided design program. So what I had to do is I had to re-establish my career. I had to move into different fields. And this was not the only time that happened to me. Actually, a number of times I had to organize my entire career in order to make sure that I keep up with technological developments. And this is something that we need to be aware that this will become more and more important for us to really be able to be agile in the way we act in our careers and the way we act in our industries. This, by the way, is also one of the reasons why I think that university education is really important. A lot of people don't realize that, but you don't go to university in order to learn a thing. This is not what you do. You don't go to the university in order to learn how to do music production or in order to learn how to kind of edit films or how to program games. You generally go to the university in order to create the level of agility that you need in order to survive in an industry that kind of changes constantly. So university education, the main purpose of university education is actually to make you agile and to make you flexible in your career and to make sure that you can sustain a career even if your main point of education or your main interest kind of suddenly disappears because of technological disruption. So yes, voiceover actors are certainly one of the fields that will be affected most, not the only one. Quite frankly, there are other disciplines that are disappearing as well. I'm thinking about copywriters, for example. If you are in that field, you probably need to think carefully about what your future is going to be. Now, that doesn't mean that all voice actors will lose their jobs, certainly not. But it means that you need to have a certain high level of skill in order to be able to survive in that industry, because you have to compete with artificial intelligence. And we need to be perfectly honest, it's much, much cheaper to do it that way. The second comment I wanted to make to your comment was the use of the term stolen. And that's actually something that relates to my first principle, critical thinking. I currently see a lot of people, or kind of society in general, really being very easy with all these big terms. There's a scam, this is stolen. This kind of, we are used to being rage baited, right? So if I make a video that has a title that is rage baity, where I kind of do something that kind of indicates that I'm very controversial, I can be sure that a lot more people are going to watch that video than if I do something that is fairly normal. So what I think is becoming really, really important is that we start to develop a certain level of critical skill in understanding what certain things mean. And in this particular case, stolen is a very strong word that I would not use in that context. And this relates to the other thing that I wanted to say with respect to Scarlett Johansson's kind of conflict with OpenAI. The case of Scarlett Johansson is actually an interesting one, because OpenAI claimed, and we are not quite sure if that's actually true, but at least that's what they claim. They claimed that they used an actress that has a similar voice because they wanted to stay close to the voice of the movie, of sort of the artificial intelligence in the movie Her. And because Scarlett Johansson, who voiced that movie, did not want to do that, they used a voice that was somewhat similar. Now, there's an interesting conundrum that comes out of that. What happens if you are a voice actor that just happens to have a voice that sounds similar to somebody who is important or well-known? Does this suddenly mean that you can't work in that field anymore? Because, you know, kind of whenever you do work for a company, you have to fear that somebody like Scarlett Johansson is going to sue that company, and then the company doesn't really want to work with you because your voice sounds too close to the original. I think there's a big issue with the fact that we are very, very quick in making judgments, while there might actually be a different explanation that is perfectly acceptable, right? So if they're working with a different actress that just happens to have the same voice, why wouldn't they be able to do that, right? So why can somebody like Scarlett Johansson claim every voice that sounds like her? And that is a big question that I think a lot of people need to answer. What does it mean to have something that sounds like AI, or maybe your work looks like AI? We have a lot of examples where artists are getting hammered by everybody because they accuse them of using AI even though they never did use AI. They kind of just happen to work in a way that looks like AI or that sounds like AI or that sounds similar to something that somebody else did. So I think we need to be really, really, really careful. And this is where the critical thinking comes in. We need to be very mindful of what we do and how we act. And we need to make sure that we don't rush to judgment where judgment is not warranted yet. And the third thing that I wanted to say to that is something that is sort of related, and that is the fact that because of we might actually run into the issue that we are doing something that looks like AI or that sounds like AI, it becomes really, really important that we document our entire creative process. So the process actually becomes more important almost than the outcome. And as I said before, we have seen these instances where the community demanded from an artist that the artist discloses his or her process in order to make sure that the artist is not using any tools that are inappropriate. And I think this is going to become really, really important. So if you're working in the creative fields, it will become standard to always document how you work and to always document your entire process so that in case somebody questions you how that was created, that you can essentially say, well, this is my process and this is the way I work and I'm using AI or I'm not using AI, but you can see clearly that is my process. And once again, this will probably become more important than the outcome itself, because the outcome, you know, kind of you can just kind of throw in an artificial intelligence, but the process, you're actually buying the process. If you are buying art from an artist, you're actually buying the process, how this art was created, and not so much the artifact that this process kind of resulted in. User Abram730 made a comment that relates to something that I said about the fact that learning or how artificial intelligence systems learn is actually not that different to how humans learn, and therefore there are some kind of issues. And the user writes, learning isn't theft and inspiration isn't theft. Some dangerous precedents could be set with this lawsuit, and the lawsuit that he is referring to is the lawsuit, obviously, between the record labels and Sunu and Udio. Now, this is really an interesting one because, once again, and I'm coming back to the idea of critical thinking, we are not yet completely clear how we actually define learning in the context of artificial intelligence. Is this the same as learning in humans, or is this something different? And you can argue one way or the other, but the fact is that legally there is no precedent on how to actually kind of define it. So one of the things that this lawsuit actually does is also it is trying to establish precedent to make sure that we have an understanding of what we actually mean by training an AI system as opposed to learning as a human. Now, the question though is, might there be a danger of kind of overestimating the importance of learning in the context of artificial intelligence? Or in other words, would there be possibilities for unintended consequences in case we are too tight in our definition of what learning actually is? And I think there could be, because there are certain tools, certain kind of systems that, for example, people with disabilities need to use that rely on the fact that the machine is learning certain things. So if we are too kind of restrictive in our definition of what learning means in the context of artificial intelligence and what is allowed and what is not allowed, we could actually have some very unintended consequences. And that is something that I think everybody should be aware of. And I'm coming back to my first principle. That essentially means that we need to really, 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 really think critically about what that actually means if we are suddenly kind of limiting learning access to computational systems. That could have very bad consequences for people. I'm just saying. User Daniel Haag 5522 writes, great video and important points. Well, thank you. Only aspect I would object is the need to become faster and more agile as well in all aspects of education, including curriculum design. Instead, we should be guided by the more sustainable core skills and values and not get distracted too much by new tech and business models all the time, in particular because many things are rather evolutions of older ideas than true revolutions. And it would be a mistake to orient the curriculum along AI or any other tech for that matter exclusively, as we can clearly see in the world that there are many more topics to address and tools to use as creators and designers. Now, Daniel Haag actually makes a really interesting point, and that in the three principles that I've defined, there is a need to balance those. And there seems to be a bit of a contradiction. On one hand, I'm recommending that we focus on critical skill development. And on the other hand, I'm saying that we need to be very agile in the way we do things. And that seems to be a contradiction, but I would argue that that is not necessarily a contradiction. We can still develop very agile curricula, for example, that are focusing on critical skill development. And we are currently doing that in our graduate programs. And I would agree with you that this is not straightforward to do. It's not something that kind of comes very naturally. It's really, really difficult to do that, but it is possible. So you can create things that are very, very agile, but at the same time also kind of foster all the critical things that we need and the understanding of how the world works and kind of being cognizant about all the the problems that we have in the world without neglecting the fact that we actually need to be very agile. So I think that's both are possible. It's not easy, but it's possible. Now, with respect to the evolution versus revolution, I would generally agree with you. However, in that particular case, I'm not entirely sure, because there are certain aspects in artificial intelligence that are unlike anything else that we had in the past. And while obviously everything has some form of evolutionary process, I think this will be a very, very rapid evolution. Probably not a revolution in the traditional sense, but it will still be kind of something that happens very, very quickly. And so it will almost appear like a revolution. But yeah, you're right. Essentially, in the end, it's an evolutionary process. It's just one that kind of is very compressed and very quick. User Ephraim5344 made a comment that referenced something that I said about how artificial intelligence systems learn and what it actually means for an AI system to know something. And that it's actually not simply stored, but it's still somewhere in there in the parameters of the AI system. And the user writes, that sounds like storing the data in a different format, nothing else. Now, that's actually a really interesting point, because in one way or the other, obviously, the data is in there. It's just not stored in a traditional sense. And you could argue that this is a new way of sampling, but it differs from our traditional way of sampling substantially. First of all, even though the data somehow is in there, it's sort of mushed together with everything else. So there is no clear way of extracting that anymore. So you cannot simply go into an LMM and then kind of take it out. So it's not like it's encoded and put into the system and then you have sort of a decoding algorithm. It just happens to be that sometimes the system spits out the data, but it's not really clear where the data is in the system. So yes, in one way or the other, this might be considered a new way of sampling and a new way of storing data, but this is completely different to anything that we've done in the past, and therefore there is a need to clearly define what it actually means to sample data and what it means to store sample data. Is this sample data that's in an LMM? Is this sample data that's in a diffusion system? Could be, depends of the definition. We just need to define that. But it is a really, really interesting question. And I think it's one of the key questions that we need to answer in order to get out of this mess in terms of copyright and what we can do and what we can't do with artificial intelligence systems. User TCQQ4EV writes, the end user of these models has the same responsibility to not infringe as they ever did. And I would actually agree with that. I've done about 50 songs with AI. In 48 cases, it worked as it should have, as they claimed. But two cases sounded damn close to the famous voices. One case, because I loved the song so much, I put in a DAW and changed the pitch of the voice so it didn't sound like the artist. The other case, I don't intend to try to monetize it in any shape or form, but I will give it away for free because it's a good song with a much heralded singer. I'll just use another version on the album. Now, this comment is interesting for a number of reasons, and the first one is the monetization question. So the user obviously monetizes some of the AI songs at least, and that is a complicated question. Are we supposed to be allowed to do that or not? Is AI generation something that we just do for fun, or is this something that we should be able to monetize? Now, in theory, we are not really able to monetize it because there is no copyright associated with anything that is created by artificial intelligence. The copyright law requires that there is a human intervention that kind of makes sure that this is actually a result of a creative process and not the result of something that a machine did. So you can't monetize that technically. You will still be able to kind of generate some sort of income, but it's not the same as you would get if you would actually create something yourself. Because if you create something yourself, you have the copyright. And that is a much, much tighter way of kind of creating monetization than just kind of creating something that is AI generated where you have no right on any copyright whatsoever. Now, the second question that's really interesting in this particular comment is the question whose responsibility it is to make sure that something that an artificial intelligence system has created based on user input is not infringing on somebody else's copyright. And I do believe, as the user does, that this is the responsibility of the end user in the end. So if you are using an AI tool and you're creating something and you're trying to monetize that, in the end, it's your responsibility to make sure that you're not violating anybody else's copyright. Now, there will be tools that allow you to check that. There are already many tools out there. So if you, for example, upload something to YouTube, YouTube has the Content ID algorithm that checks if there are any copyright infringements that you've done by uploading that particular video to YouTube. And I believe that many AI systems will also have the need to really integrate such content ID systems to make sure that the end users actually has the ability to check if something is infringing copyright. But because the systems are really not deterministic, they're really probabilistic, the system generator, the system creator has no way of making sure that the system really always ensures that there are no copyright infringements. In the end, it always has to be the end user who creates something with the help of an AI system that needs to double check if that is actually, that the system has created is actually violating any copyright. User VJREI writes, AI should be washing dishes and doing laundry so we can create in peace. Now, this is a comment that you've probably heard a lot and that might already have achieved meme status. And that relates to a paradox, really, in artificial intelligence research. And that is the fact that artificial intelligence systems are really good in the things that we humans are bad at, and they are really bad in the things that humans are good at. I believe that paradox even has a particular name. Can't remember which one, but that doesn't make any difference. Now, obviously, we would like to have AI systems to do the menial tasks of our daily lives as well. And believe me, there are companies out there who are currently trying to do that. There's actually a really interesting business model for these types of AI systems, because just think of it, if you reach a certain age, you might need certain assistive technologies that help you in kind of just getting through the day, some robot that washes your dishes and so that you can live alone at an advanced age. So there is actually a real business incentive for companies to do that. The fact that this has not happened yet is just because it is so incredibly hard to do that. It's actually really easy to create an AI system that can kind of reason about the most complicated physics problems, but it's really, really difficult to create an AI system that can do the most simple menial tasks. That's one of the paradoxes that we're facing. And that's everything I wanted to say today. Now, I would really be interested in your opinions about this topic. Do you agree with me? Do you disagree? And if so, why? I'm honestly curious to hear your thoughts about that. Leave your comments below, or you can also join us on our Discord server for a chat. And as always, if you've enjoyed this video, please don't forget to hit that like button and subscribe. And with that being said, I'll see you all in the next video.